Let's now take a look at a situation. I'm going to call this for fun. There are situations where we want to do something, a task, over and over and over again. So let's say I wanted to print out the squareds, right? So I'm going to start out with one and say system.out.println. 1 squared is, now I can actually do it in my head, but this is the reason we invented computers, so we didn't have to do this kind of stuff in our head. So 1 times 1, I'm going to have it do the math and print that out. Okay, so if I save and run this, it'll say 1 squared is 1. Okay, and then if I want to do 2, then I can come back in here and say system.out.println 2 squared is, and then 2 times 2. Okay, 3, system.out.println 3 squared is 3 times 3. Well, let's say I'm going all the way down to 15. The temptation at this point will be to say, okay, let's just copy this and paste it down there, and then I'm just going to change these numbers. So 4, 4 times 4, 5, 5, 5, 6, 6, 6. Anyway, this is a pretty annoying process, and by the way, copying is a horrible idea in most cases. Most of the time when I've thought that I could save time by copying and pasting, I've actually ended up spending more time. I just did this last week. I was working on an Android project, an app, and I copied and pasted a chunk of code to save some time, and then my code wasn't working right. Well, it turned out that I'd forgotten to change one of these little things that I thought I was going to change, and so it was overriding the same variable over and over and over again instead of overriding to a new variable. Just a bad idea. And so, but we get tempted to do that when we're doing these repetitive processes, right? Well, whenever we see this type of a situation where we're doing something over and over and over and over again, and the only thing that's changing is something very minor in it, then that tells us that it's probably a good situation to use a loop. And the loops work like this. We set it up and we say we want to keep doing this particular thing over and over and over again until we meet a certain condition. And there's a few different types of loops. We have when it's a definitive number, when we know exactly how many times we want to execute, even if we don't know when we're writing the program, but we will know at the time that the program's being executed. If we know how many times we want it to execute, then we use what's called a for loop. Okay? And so that's referred to as a definite loop. And so in this case, I can say I want to go up to 15. Isn't that what I said I wanted to do? So for a certain condition, then I want to print out system.out.println something, a number squared is, and then whatever that number is, times itself. So number times number. Okay? So I want to start this number at 1, and I want this number to go up to 15. Okay? So let me create a variable here to store that number. So an int number equals 1. Let's start it at 1. Okay? So then I want to do this thing 15 times, right? Well, what I actually want to do is print out whatever's in the number. So number squared is number times number, and then increment that number, right? So I want to set number equal to number plus 1. So put into number whatever number was plus 1, or we can use the shortcut by just saying number plus plus. Add one on to number. Okay? So that's what we're going to do each time we come through to print out the squares. Well, the for loop, now we have to determine or define the condition. And we do that by declaring a variable that acts as a counter, let's say. So I'm going to call it a count variable. And I'm going to start the count at 1. And I'm going to go how many times? Well, I said we want to do up to 15. So I want to go count is less than or equal to 15. Okay? So there's three parts to every for loop. The first part is a variable that we're setting to start the loop, and then we set up the condition that will end the loop, or better said, the condition that will keep doing the loop for. So as long as the count is less than or equal to 15, then we'll keep doing what's ever inside these braces. Okay, and then what are we going to do with the count each time? That's the third part. Well, each time we come through, I want to increment the count by 1. So the count's going to keep track of which time we are through this loop. And then each time we come through the loop, I'm going to print out whatever's in number. And then I'm going to increment that number, and we're going to do the same thing again. Okay, so let's try running this and see what happens. If I compile and run this, then I get 1 squared equals 1, 2 squared equals 4, 3 squared equals 9, all the way up through 15 squared is 225, and then the program ends. All right? Now, which way was easier? The way I did it initially, by printing out each statement, and maybe that would have been easier to 15, I don't know, but what if I wanted to do the squareds to 100? Well, now all I have to do is change this number from 15 to 100. And it'll run through the squareds to 100. 100 squared is 10,000. Well, that would have been a lot of print lines, right? And my father is the one who taught me a lot of my programming skills. And he taught me that a good programmer is lazy. They'll set something up, they'll work really hard one time to set something up so that they never have to do it again. And that's this situation. We've now set it up. Let's do our squares to 1,000. All we need to change is one number. And now it'll print out to 1,000 squared is 1,000,000. This is a much more simple way of doing it. So loops are really helpful to us. Just a few more thoughts on this loop, though. Let's just for fun print out each time we come through the loop. Let me just do this. I'm going to comment out this code for printing that out. And instead, what I'm going to print out is the number. So I'm going to print out the word number and then whatever is in the number. And then I'm going to print out the word count and whatever's in the count, okay? For each number. In fact, maybe I'll do this. Maybe I'll say I'm just going to print that rather than a print line, so it'll stay on the same line. And then after that, I'll concatenate on a comma and a space so that it'll print it all out on the same line. And then this one will be the print line to take it down to the next line. Does that make sense? Okay, so if we run this, let's go back to 15. Sorry, that was a lot of numbers. And then run this. Let's look at our output. Notice that the number and the count are the same for each time we go through the loop. And that makes sense because I'm starting the number at 1, I'm starting the count at 1, I increment the number, I increment the count. And so what you'll see programmers do as you know, you get more into programming is that they will, instead of creating a separate variable for number, they'll just use the same number. So we already know the count is going to start at 1 and go to 15, so why even mess around with this number variable? Why instead don't we take this line here, and then we can even, well, let's do this. So I'll put count here, and then I'll substitute here count times count. And then I don't need to increment the number because that's already being handled by the loop here with the count. And so each time we come through, the count is incremented. So now if I run this, it's going to function exactly as it functioned before, but we've reduced the code. We've made it a little less cluttered because we're just using the count variable that we created to keep track of what time we were on the loop, if that makes sense. The other thing that happens for programmers is that we get kind of lazy, and rather than creating a big word here that we have to type in over and over again, a lot of times what you'll see in a loop in Java is that they'll just use a variable I, and that's kind of the standard variable for a loop. You'll see that it's very common to say I equals 1 or whatever to keep track of your loop. And so then this will become an I, this will become an I, and then all of these will become I's, and we'll have to I times I there. And if we run this, we get the exact same thing, except for this is the way you'd see it in real life. This is how programmers would do it in most cases. We just set up a variable called I, that's the counter, and then we tell the counter what we want it to do. In essence, the counter becomes the number variable that we're messing around with in the first place. We set it equal to a 1, and then we say while that I variable is less than or equal to 15, then increment I each time we come through this loop, and let's look at it. So we come in and we say I is equal to 1, so we'll print 1. 1 squared is 1 times 1, or 1. We hit the bottom of the loop. I is incremented to 2. We come back up and say, is 2 less than or equal to 15? Yes, it is. So let's come in. Now 2 squared is 2 times 2, or 4. And we get 2 squared is 4. Hit the bottom of the loop, come back up to the top. I is incremented to 3. Is 3 less than or equal to 15? Yes, it is. So let's go in and print out our statement. 3 squared is 3 times 3, or 9. And then fast forward. We keep incrementing until we get to 15. Okay, down here to 15. Okay, we hit the bottom. We come back up to the top. I is incremented to 16. And we say, is 16 less than or equal to 15? The answer is no, so we exit the loop and we continue on with whatever code is below. All right? So that's a for loop, and that's very useful, again, when we know how many times we want to execute something. Even if we were asking the user how many squares, to what squared number do you want to do, and allowed them to enter 100 as the number, and then put that here, you know, num squares, and then had that as a variable, we still know at this point in the program how many times that's going to execute because we've already asked the user for it up here somewhere, right? As long as we know by the time we hit the loop how many times we're going to do this loop, then the for is a really good way to go. Okay? All right. Spencer out.